I'd like to call the Roseville City Council meeting for October 23rd, 2012 to order. May we please rise and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Under routine matters, minutes of regular meeting held October 23rd, 2012.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor to approve the minutes. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is approval of disbursement list.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. Is there any discussion on disbursement list this evening? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Correspondence, Mr. Clerk.
Mayor, I have no correspondence, but if I may, I'd like to make a brief announcement. Some of you may have read or seen in the local news in the last day or so regarding Auburn Hills and absentee ballots not being received by voters requesting. I've received numerous phone calls of people who have not received their absentee ballots. It appears I've narrowed down to those that were mailed on or about October the 9th. Several people out of state. If you have friends or relatives at any of the local universities, Michigan State, U of M, Central Michigan, it appears a lot of those individuals have not received their absentee ballots. I assure you, I personally delivered them to the post office. They were mailed out from the city of Roseville through the post office. I've been working closely with the postmaster at the city of Roseville, trying to determine what the status is on those particular ballots. I do know there are some people in the city of Roseville where the husband may have received it and the wife may have not. I'm continuously working with the post office. I'm making an effort. What I'm going to do is I'll be sending a postcard out to all those that we have not received or heard any correspondence back on the absentee ballots. I'm asking those people if they hopefully get the postcard, they can contact our office immediately. Let us know if they have in fact received their ballot, and if so, they no hurry to return it. But if they did not receive it, we can process it and reissue them a ballot. Any of those ballots that will be reissued will be spoiled, and there's a process in which those ballots would not be in harm's way. They would not be in the hands of anybody to do any ill will with them. Once they're spoiled, they will not be able to be counted. I am making an effort with the post office on a daily basis, and I will be mailing those postcards out tomorrow. So anybody that in the viewing audience that may have a relative out of state that they know requested a ballot that lives in the city of Roseville or one of the universities, please have them contact our office immediately so we can rectify this problem. The phone number you can reach our office is 586-445-5443, or you can email us at the city clerk's office, and that email address is cityclerk@roseville-mi.gov. I would also like to indicate that the city clerk's office is going to be open on Saturday, November the 3rd, weekend before the election, from 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. to take care of any last-minute absentee ballot requests for emergency purposes or such. But I can assure you those issues with regard to anybody that may have not received their absentee ballot, the sooner we can make contact with any of those individuals, the sooner we can rectify the problem. And again, we can only apologize for the inconvenience, but it is due to issues beyond our control. I personally delivered those ballots to the post office, and I can guarantee that they were properly distributed. Post office is looking into it again. If you have any issues regarding that, please contact our office immediately so we can get that taken care of as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Next item is hearing of a public. Public comments on agenda items will be heard at the first hearing. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address, address the chair. You are welcome to direct questions, input information, and or express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order and will correct your language or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Anyone not adhering to these rules will be called out of order by the chair. Does anybody from the public wish to be heard on agenda items only? Anybody from the public wish to be heard on agenda items only? Seeing none, we will move into new business. public hearing date in connection with application to create a commercial rehabilitation exemption certificate for C.H. McComb LLC, 20891 East 13 Mile Road. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, as mentioned at the special meeting last week, the petitioner has requested that this item be tabled by council. They are still working on their property acquisition finalization at this point, and it will be before council after that process has been completed.
Okay. So can I have a motion to table, please?
So moved. Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. The item is tabled. Next item is public hearing and board consideration with application to amend an industrial development district and create an industrial facilities exemption certificate for RCO Engineering, Inc., 29100 Callahan Road, 29200 Callahan Road, 29300 Callahan Road, and 15711 12 Mile Road, and 15725 12 Mile Road. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, on the October 9th meeting, council set the public hearing. The item was addressed by representatives from RCO at your special meeting, and Mr. Connors is here this evening with a presentation. Following the public hearing, I've also put a memo on your desk in front of each of you. You will also be asked to take additional action, which will be the approval of the industrial facilities exemption certificate per the request and application. And Mr. Connors is okay.
Mr. Connors, are you ready?
Yep. Good evening. For nearly 40 years, RCO Engineering has called the city of Roseville home. They now occupy six industrial facilities, totaling 315,559 square feet of industrial space. The company has a diversified portfolio, which includes production plastic and metal parts, prototype and production seat molds, injection molds, and a full-service aluminum foundry, as well as product design and engineering services. That services the automotive, defense, and aerospace industries. The company currently employs 791 employees. This expansion, as proposed, will create an additional 34 jobs. The new investment of the project is over $6.2 million, which includes $5.6 million to purchase new machinery and equipment, and $525 towards personal real property improvements. As Scott had mentioned, this is a new investment, a new industrial facilities exemption request. Looking to, RCO is essentially building a campus with their six buildings, and one of the new parcels they purchased at 15725 East 12 Mile Road is adjacent to their existing property. So we'd like to amend that district to include that parcel as well, and then a new wife to on the new investment. So we have a presentation here tonight. We have Deb Mack with RCO, who's going to run through some slides, tell you a little bit about the company.
Okay. Ms. Mack.
Oh, thank you.
Could you give your name and address for the record, please?
Hi, I'm Debbie Mack. I'm the Chief Financial Officer representing RCO Engineering, located at 29200 Callahan Road and 15686 Sturgeon.
Okay. Yeah, you proceed.
Okay. All right, so. Is this on? All right. So 12 is a key number in my presentation tonight. We're here to request an amendment to our industrial development district to include our newest facility located at 15725 12 Mile Road, and to request two 12-year industrial facility tax exemptions, also known as abatements. This presentation is intended to give you our history, outline our plans, and reasons why RCO should be granted a 12-year exemption. RCO is a second-generation, family-owned business that was established in 1973. We are primarily a tool and die shop with six employees located on East Lance Street in a 7,500-square-foot building. In 1988, we outgrew the four buildings on Eastland, and we purchased the 38,000 square foot facility in Bacon Land and moved our headquarters to 29200 Callahan Road. Shown here, we have made many improvements over the years. In 1989, we built a 58,000 square foot building at 29250 Callahan. In 1990, we purchased 29100 Callahan, an 18,000 square foot building, and invested in major renovations. In 1995, we joined 29200 and 250 with a 22,000 square foot addition. In 1997, we added another 18,000 square feet to our headquarters. In 2000, we purchased 15686 Sturgeon, adding 85,000 square feet to our manufacturing operations. We invested again in landscaping and interior improvements. And this past summer, we actually redid all the landscaping and fenced the property. In 2001, we purchased 15711 12 Mile Road, which added another 18,000 square feet. Major investments were made to improve the exterior, interior, and landscaping of this building. In 2004, we added 24,000 more square feet with the purchase of 29300 Callahan, and again made it have our campus feel with the landscaping and the exterior. Last month, we purchased this 37,000 square foot building, which is located at 15725 12 Mile Road, and the building we're asking to amend on our IDD. This is an aerial view of our Roseville properties today. The red area is the newest building, and the purplish-bluish area there shows our other facilities that we occupy. We pay taxes on over 300,000 square feet of real estate, as well as property taxes on all of the equipment contained in these facilities. The newest building on 12 Mile Road was purchased to support our growth in the aerospace industry. Our intent is to update the exterior of the building, again giving it the campus feel, and we anticipate spending over $300,000 to renovate the exterior and make necessary improvements to the interior of the building. Over the next 24 months, we also have plans to spend $225,000 in real property improvements at our other facilities and purchase $5.7 million of new equipment to support growth in both our aerospace and automotive business units. We want to increase our capacity, reduce the work we outsource, and perform as much work as possible at RCO. We attribute much of our success to our highly skilled and loyal workforce. Over 80% of our employees are professional, management, engineering, or skilled tradesmen. The majority of our employees reside in the Tri-County area. 56% of them are Macomb County residents. 35 of our employees reside in Roseville. And in fact, we had many of them come support us today, and thank you for your attendance tonight. RCO and its employees generously support and host many outreach programs. We have quarterly blood drives. We contribute to various Roseville projects. We have an annual food drive. We support DARE, fire department programs, high school kids graduating from foster care, and we support the Lighthouse Outreach Center in Roseville, and we have a very successful Adopt a Family program where we adopt 12 to 15 families each year and buy gifts for over 300 kids through five different charities, and that's all through employee contributions. In May, the City of Roseville adopted a tax incentive scoring system to help make recommendations to the City Council when determining abatement terms. The text and chart shown here were copied right from the city's policy. The highlighted lines indicate our placement on the scoring chart. Based on this system, we receive the following scores. For real property, purchases of $525,000, 3 years. Personal property, 7 years. Our job creation, we anticipate over 30 new jobs in the next 24 months, 2 years. We're north of 12 Mile Road, that gives us 1 year. And we're headquartered in Roseville, that's another year. The total score is 14 years. However, the state regulation limits the city to granting us 12 years. In addition to the scoring system, RCO should be granted the full 12 years allowed by the state because our continued success has increased the tax base and revenues to the city. RCO has paid over $5 million in Roseville property taxes since 2001. Even with the 12-year abatement, we will pay more taxes because of our planned purchases. Local businesses also gained from our success. Since 2011, RCO has purchased $2.5 million from Roseville businesses. And indirect purchases are almost impossible for us to measure, but we know because of our increased headcount, Roseville businesses are also benefiting when our employees go out to eat lunch and buy gas. Additionally, neighboring communities such as St. Clair Shores, Fraser, and Warren are granting 12-year abatements. RCO continues to be a great neighbor and taxpayer. We've been in the city for over 39 years. Our properties are well maintained. We've won many beautification awards, including the Golden Phoenix Award. We support our community, and we have a proven track record. Our diversification efforts have been successful, and just helping us grow and increase the tax base to the city. RCO is requesting this incentive to help us remain competitive, not only in the global market in which we compete, but locally. RCO's competitors are getting 12-year abatements from neighboring communities. We're not asking for a handout, but rather a helping hand. We have been good for Roseville and are asking for your support as we continue to grow our business and the tax base in the city of Roseville. The 12-year abatement only applies to new purchases and would be a 50% relief of taxes on, again, only the new equipment and renovations for the period approved. Our existing real estate and equipment will not receive any benefit. Approval of a 12-year abatement will still add new dollars to the city. Granting a 12-year abatement is a win-win for Roseville, its residents, and businesses. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions to the petitioner this evening? Okay, seeing none, this is a public hearing. Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard on this issue this evening? Anybody wish to be heard on this evening? Okay, seeing none, can I have a motion to close the public hearing?
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. The public hearing is closed. Does the council have any other questions for Mr. Atkins or for the petitioners? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council in this regard? Do you want to speak, Mr.?
Yes, Your Honor. Members of council, you'll need to consider three action items. Actually, you'll have to do an amendment to the agenda. You can do that individually if you choose. For each of the items that you go through, because this action step did not occur, or you can do them as you proceed. So you can do a collective amendment to consider action items for agenda items 2, 3, and 4, or if you wish, as you go through each one, you can do an amendment, and then the separate action items for the amendment of the district, and then the action on the industrial facilities certificate itself.
Do you understand what he means when you need an action item? Because the as listed on the agenda, it says public hearing. Typically, after number two, we would include
board consideration.
Board consideration, yes. Or council consideration to grant the application. So that's what Scott's referring to. I know that I'm not sure that was entirely clear, but that's okay. What you need to do. Either do it individually, which is the way it typically is, or add them all together, but my suggestion would be just to do it individually.
Just and the other point I was making is because it doesn't appear on your agenda, you should probably amend your agenda also.
Well, if we amend the agenda with 2, 3, and 4, and 5, then we wouldn't have to do it at every.
Correct. Yeah, because your agenda did not show any other action beside public hearing.
Okay. So can I have a motion from the council then regarding amending the agenda for 2, 3, 4, and 5 then?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty to amend the agenda for action and review on each one of these items, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
So, are we going to cast three different votes on RCO? One to enlarge the district, one on the first abatement, one on the sturgeon abatement.
That's correct. That's exactly
okay,
how
so
it should
be done.
So we
got to go through each one of those.
The first
and
one.
What we just did took care of that. We can take action on all three of those.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, so what? Go ahead.
One other question. Mr. Atkins, we just had a presentation from RCO, and We've gone through this, we've heard it, we've asked the questions, but the public that are watching tonight just saw a presentation and no questions from the council table, and we're gonna make thousands of dollars worth of decisions here shortly, I do believe. Can you summarize what we've already done?
Sure.
So that the residents know we're actually not just floating through this?
Sure. To summarize the best that I can, first of all, an application was received by the petitioner, in this case RCO, which is formalized application from the State of Michigan Department of Treasury requesting an exemption under the industrial facilities tax, which is Public Act 198. Under that act, the council then accepts through the clerk's office the application and a payment of an application fee. The council then sets up a public hearing, which you did on October 9th. The next step is the council entertains a special meeting, which is open to the public, inviting representatives from the company to come in, explain the request, Also, you'll receive a very detailed packet. The packets in this case are about a half an inch in detail that shows all of the financial information, because this petition is received by the city, also reviewed by the building department, the development coordinator, myself, and the city assessor. That information then is summarized, given to council, discussed at your special meeting, and then brought back for an action step at this meeting. So it actually is essentially a four-part process that's done in a review. So everything from counting the dollars to making sure that job creation and investment is followed, and in accordance with the policy that the council put in place that requires those type of steps to be done before any consideration is given. I hope that helps.
Thank you. I just know there's a lot of legwork that we've already done, and I wanted the public to understand that. Thank you.
Also, if I may, the public hearings are a legal publication that are published in the newspaper as well on all of these.
Any other further questions? What are the wishes of the council?
Mr. Mayor, make a motion to do the first of these three things, which is to add the 157-25-12 mile to the IFT district.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Swatowski to grant the application for the IDD and create an industrialism facility exemption certificate for RCO Engineering 29100 Callahan, 29200 Callahan, 29300 Callahan, and 157-11-12 mile and 157-25-12 mile. So I have a motion by Councilman Swatowski, supported by Councilman Iudo. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is public hearing and board consideration in connection with application to create an industrial facilities exemption certificate for RCO Engineering at 15686 Sturgeon. Mr. Atkins.
Actually, Mayor, can we back up? The next step is we need to approve the actual application and certificate for the original petition with regard to the 29100 Callahan. You've amended the district, which is what the motion was just now.
Okay.
Now you actually have to have a motion to approve or deny the application to grant or to create the industrial facilities exemption certificate.
Which is the 12-year request.
Correct.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we got to talk about the years and how much. Just looking at it, the last seven we've done, we've never given 12 totally, but we've never had one this big out of the last seven. This is twice the size of out of the last seven, pretty much. And it's been our practice the last few of these to make a distinction between real and personal. And this request is almost 90% personal, and that's one we've been more lenient on the personal. So I'm thinking 12. I'm convinced on the personal for 12. I mean, it is a tremendous facility. I'm so pleased with the expansion and all. But again, city has great financial difficulties, and you know, our property tax is not growing at what we projected it to grow at, you know, in our last budget. So we got to be a little careful. We want a partnership, but you know, we got to be mindful of the city's budget also. So I'd suggest 6 years on the real property, 12 years on the personal, which gives them, you know, really the bulk of what they want. It's almost 90% personal. It's all equipment going in there, really expensive laser machine tool, you know, really sophisticated equipment. But you know, we got to be mindful of the city's condition. So I think 6 would be reasonable on the real property.
Is that in the form of a motion?
Yes.
Okay, do we have a support?
I'll support that.
Okay, supported by Councilman Iudo. Any discussion? Councilman Taylor.
I'm a little confused with the, we get to minimum 4-year, they qualify for the 4-year on the real property, is that correct?
No, on this, their total calculation actually qualifies them for 14 years on real and personal combined. The sturgeon is a second issue, which you may be thinking about on a lower amount for personal, but on this request, real and personal, 14 years, our policy and the state law only allow a maximum of 12. So, and that's according to the scoring criteria that we put together and approved here.
Mr. Swatowski's motion was for 6 years on the real property, is that correct?
Correct. He's proposing, if I understand correct, a division between, differentiation between real and personal, splitting those two.
Okay. I would be more apt to give them maybe a 10-year on the real property. That's just my opinion. They got a wonderful business here. They got over 800, around 800 employees. We got employees here from Roseville that are obviously in the crowd here today. I think they're doing a wonderful job with their business, and I don't want to stay here, so that's just my
Mayor Pro Tem, let me just, because I think Councilman Swatowski's motion was for 12 years on the real and 6 for the property.
Uh-uh.
12
on the personal.
12 on the personal, I'm sorry.
I'm saying 12 and 10.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor? I think 10 sounds like a good number, or 8 sounds like a good number. 10, 6, yep, I'll meet you in the middle. 8 years on the real property.
It's negotiations at the table.
Yeah.
Right.
Just like think of the last two. We gave the last one on Peninsula, we gave 4 and 8. We gave 8 and 12 on Comfort before that. So we're right in that area. So I think 12 and 8 is good. And you're right, the next one we're going to do, sturgeon, the recommendation is 4 years from the administration. So that 4 is out there, but that's on the next one.
Okay. I would support that.
Okay. Well, we've got a motion on the floor right now first.
Did they change his motion?
Friendly amendment to 10.
Okay. Councilman Swatowski thinks this is the House floor. So we're dickering here. So. Anyway, so
I can live with 8.
You can live with 8?
I can live with 8.
Okay. So we have a friendly amendment for 12 and 8. Any further discussion?
Mr. Ayudo has to second that.
Okay. Yeah, are you good with that?
I will support that second.
Okay.
I will amend my second.
All right. So we have a motion with an amendment, a second with an amendment. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Now, public hearing and council consideration in connection with the application to create an industrial facilities exemption certificate for RCO Engineering 15686 Sturgeon. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. Again, a petition was received and an application to the city clerk's office. The council discussed the item and set a public hearing on October 9th. And again, a presentation and discussion was held at your most recent special meeting a week ago. This request comes before you in regards to personal property. And in the scoring criteria, they do meet a criteria scoring of 4 years on the personal property. However, due to the extenuating circumstances that have been presented by the petitioner, they are requesting consideration of the maximum of 12. Certainly, it is within the policy guidelines of the council can create additional or change the requirements, as you're aware. So again, you have the ability to approve up to a 12-year as well on this.
Okay, are there any questions by the council to the petitioners or the city manager?
Mayor, I would, I can't believe I'm going higher than the city recommendation of 4, but to make it consistent with the last one, I'd suggest 8 years on the
Before you make your motion,
we got to have a public hearing. We got to do a public hearing.
Sorry, it's a little confusing because of the agenda. So it's, I just want to make sure that we're doing it properly. So you need to do the public hearing still.
So do you have a question?
Sorry.
No, I want to hear from the public.
Mayor Pro Tem, do you have a question? Okay. So this is a public hearing in connection with the application to create a industrial facilities exemption certificate for RCO Engineering 15686 Sturgeon. Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard? Come on, ma'am, you're the petitioner, but
One comment about separating them and giving them different periods.
Could I ask your name and address?
Oh, Debbie Mack, RCO Engineering, 29200 Callahan, 15686 Sturgeon. Is that, we just don't own the lot in between, which is why it's two separate facilities. It really is a joint effort to support all of our business operations. And as a matter of day-to-day business, there are times when we move equipment from one facility to another to accommodate growth in a certain aspect of our operations. I think giving different periods for that building is going to confuse things with not only us, but the city when we go to report things to the assessor's office. So if, I would just like you to take that into consideration when you take your vote.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard? Sir, come on up. Step on up.
Hello, how y'all doing?
Good. Could I have your name and address for
my record? Name is Alfred Hodges, Reverend Alfred Hodges. I live at 27470 Wentworth Drive. I just think you should support RCO because they really do a great work. They really help people. And I mean, some of the people that are so outstanding. I mean, you know, you don't work in too many businesses where the owners talk to you and conversate with you, ask you how you feeling, and different things. And it's a guy that works there. He has Down syndrome. And it's funny because, you know, most people won't hire people with Down syndrome. You know, yeah, some people will, but, I mean, RCO is great. They help you. And, you know, I was looking for a job for a long time. I was out of work, and they gave me an opportunity. So anything they want to do, I'm going to be supporting them because they helped me out the whole. And I think you should grant them the years they need. Thank you. God
Thank
bless you,
sir. Anybody else wish to be heard? Is anybody else? Can I have a motion to close the public hearing then?
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman McCartney, to close the public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Public hearing is closed. Is there any further questions for the petitioner?
Yes. One question for the petitioner. Ms. Mack, did I understand your comments there? Are you saying it's best if the real property rate is consistent between Sturgeon and the Callahan facilities?
So
moving equipment back and forth.
Right, for our property rates.
It's the same, property. It doesn't affect the, yeah.
Correct. Since 12 years was granted for the other facility, we would appreciate 12 years there. So if we move equipment around, we don't have to be mindful of that was really only an 11-year exemption or whatever if it was something different.
And this one's all personal property, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Mayor, if I may, the point Ms. Mack makes is a very good point, actually, about the personal property and the, because you have a unique situation where you do have a campus environment and these type of businesses do transfer properties between various buildings just depending on their needs. So the request to ask for the 12 years, and when you take it into consideration of the whole, what you're dealing with as far as the total personal investment, to be quite frank, they could have just included that and added it into the other IFT, but they, you know, they're being forthright and honest. This is where their intent to place this property is, at least from the starting point. So I think if you add that all together, clearly they would qualify for that 12-year abatement. And I think the point Ms. Mack brings about the transferring the property is a very good point because it is an issue that the assessing department would have to deal with.
Mr. Atkins?
Yes, Mayor. And that is the reason the justification, as we have mentioned, even though the scoring criteria may be a different request, is for consideration of the full 12 years on the second piece because of that difference in the property issue as well.
Okay. Ms. Mack, I have some questions for you because it wasn't brought up. How many people in your organization live in the city of Roseville?
35.
And how many more people? I think you're in your
Over
presentation it was 30.
Yeah, right now we anticipate 31.
And are they, what kind of jobs are they?
There are a lot of skilled jobs. There are jobs that are going to be helping in the aerospace group, what we have with our seat building group. So there's some people that will be quality inspectors, some people will be assembling, primarily
skilled.
Where
do you draw your pool out of candidates?
All over. We use the internet, and that goes out to several different local agencies, as well as Macomb Community College and Baker College, so we get a lot of applicants from there. I'm trying to think of the other, there's a county, you know, Michigan Works. Michigan Works, we get them from there. We also have, in our facilities, we have boards outside of our facilities in the streets of Roseville that show what are the job openings as well, so that helps.
Okay. Do you prefer if a Roseville resident meets your qualifications, do you hire them because of the proximity of the location of your business towards your home?
Well, yeah, they're not going to miss work because of snow or anything like that. They're going to be there. So if they're qualified, we do like to hire them.
Okay.
For those reasons.
Are there any other questions? What's the wishes of the council? Councilman Swatowski.
Well, I was hoping we were going to get away with 8 on the on this one, because, but I was thinking it was real. This one is all personal, and that's what we've been more lenient on. So I think it does make sense to make them consistent. So I'll make a motion for 12 years on this one.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Swatowski to grant a 12-year abatement, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is public hearing and council consideration in connection with application to establish a plant rehabilitation district and create an industrial facility exemption certificate for American Modular Tooling LLC, Paul W. Marino Gauges, Inc., 30744 Grossbeck Highway and 30810 Grossbeck Highway. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. Again, as in the other matters that were before you previously, an application was received through the clerk's office, was processed through the council, and council on October 9th set a public hearing to consider the request from American Modular Tooling for the establishment of a plant rehabilitation district and also industrial development district. In addition, they will have a request for a industrial development tax exemption. Mr. Connors is also here to speak on this matter. And again, I've notated in a memo to you the separate items that will have to occur afterwards based upon their application requests. This will have requests for transfers from existing certificates currently held in the city of Warren, requesting to be transferred into the city of Roseville.
Okay. Mr. Tomlinson, is there two motions that need to be taken care of with the establishment of the plant rehabilitation district and one for the industrial facilities exemption certificate?
Correct. You'll have to have a motion to establish the districts first.
Okay.
Okay. And they correct me if I'm wrong, but the IDD should apply to both the rehabilitation district for the entire parcel too, right? Okay. So you could do that in one motion, all right, establishing the plant rehabilitation district and the industrial development district. And then you're going to be requested to do the 7-year exemption certificate, new and real personal property, request for 6-year exemption certificate and 5-year exemption certificate transfer, and then consider a request for five-year exemption, a transfer certificate on the other property.
So how many motions in?
Those will be 3 separate motions after the establishment of the district.
4 total.
Okay.
Yeah. Number one, to establish. The first motion is going to be to establish the districts, and the other ones are going to address the specific certificates that are being requested and the transfer.
Okay. Mr. Mayor, can I just clarify that in my mind?
Go ahead.
All right, I got the first one. We're going to create the district. Second one is, on the summary, it's the 307-44-12-mile. Then the third one is the 308-10-12-mile. And then the last one, the fourth one, is that transfer, that move in the 5-year thing that's already in Warren, the, at 307-44. Is that what the 4 motions are?
I think the second one, you have the 6-year exemption certificate and a 5-year transfer. Isn't that correct?
That's correct.
Right.
Mike? Right. On the 308-10.
There's 2 transfers. 810 and 744.
I think we have to do something.
You'll have to do, you'll actually have to do, I believe, 2 motions on that. One for the new request and then one for the transfer.
First motion is on the agenda.
You can see what you're not there.
Mr. Tomlinson, can you guide us since the, this is kind of ambiguous in our agenda, so can you guide us through here?
I think it's on that sheet.
The only difference.
First one is to create it, and then one, two, three, those three bullets?
Correct.
Is that what?
That's the way.
Correct.
Two.
They can do the combination.
Three.
Which one?
Not the second one, it's the same thing as the third one.
Different address, Bobby.
Yeah, it's the same one.
No, it's a different address.
Oh, different address, okay.
But that one's a transfer.
Yeah.
That's why.
It's the same address, but a transfer.
It's a different address.
So you look at the agenda, you got three the same.
This is the same as this.
Right?
One and three is the same.
On the bullets?
Yeah.
One's a transfer of an existing. The third one, the first one's a new one.
With different properties.
Mr. Mayor.
Oh, boy.
Go ahead, Sam.
Mr. Tomlinson?
Mm-hmm.
Do we need to amend the agenda again?
It should be amended to include those action items, correct?
Okay.
Can they do that items? That was done.
It was a little bit unclear how they did it.
One, two, three, and four.
So Mayor, I'm going to ask to amend the agenda to add item, I guess we'll call it 4A. Consider a request for a seven-year exemption certificate at 30744 Grosbeck Highway, new, real, and personal property. Add agenda item 4B, consider a request for a six-year exemption certificate and five-year exemption certificate, transfer at 30810 Grosbeck Highway, real property transfer from City of Warren. And finally, 4C, consider a request for a five-year exemption certificate transfer at 30744 Grosbeck Highway, personal property transfer from City of Warren.
So we have a motion. Do we have support?
Support.
Support by Councilwoman McCartney. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. The agenda has been amended to reflect Sam's motion. So.
Okay, it's public hearing.
Mr. Connors, do you have anything to add to this?
Yeah.
Okay. Floor is yours.
Thank you.
In case you didn't know, it's National Industrial Facilities Mix-Up Night, so. It's always this time of year. And we've had a few tricky ones, so so bear with us. Thank you. American Modular Tooling has been established in 1991 and resided in neighboring Warren for over 22 years. After downsizing from a facility in Warren, the company has relocated the headquarters and operations here in Roseville with a desire to rehabilitate a 16,657 square foot functionally obsolete facility, with plans to expand the new facility located at 30744 Grosbeck Highway. They also brought with them the signature Merino M along Grosbeck as a landmark and establishment of their new home here in Roseville. The company manufactures high quality, low cost, environmentally responsible tooling to industries in the forms of kits, individual components, and complete design and build tools. They currently employ seven employees. This expansion will retain seven employees and create an additional seven employees over the next 2 years. The total investment is roughly $1.5 million, $354,000 to renovate the existing structure, the transfer of the IFT from Warren, and $500,000 new machinery equipment, and $700,000, and they're building the new facility, the new 10,000 square foot facility on the vacant parcel next door. So we have with us here Linda Marino from American Tooling, if you have further questions for the
okay.
petitioner.
Does the council have any questions for Ms. Marino?
Just if I could.
Please come forward. State your name and address for the record.
Good evening. Linda Marino, and I'm at 30744.
You can pull that microphone down.
Didn't bring my lifts today.
So just looking at your request, the first one, the 30744 12 mile. It's $500,000 in personal property and $350,000 in real property. And then the 30810 is $354,000 in in real property, is that right?
That's approximate, yes.
Yeah, so that's exactly the same as the real property on the 30744 12 mile?
I'm sorry.
The amount, what I've got in front of me, $354,000 on the real property and $354,000 on the real property on the 30744 12 mile. So those two different parcels are the same in real property.
Well, one property is undeveloped at this time, and our plans will be to expand onto that property with an office building, engineering center, and inventory demonstration area. We have estimates at this time. We have not had an opportunity to get actuals.
Okay.
The building that we are currently rehabilitating, we're not sure exactly how much that's going to cost, so these are approximates.
Okay, so if I'm just looking at the whole thing, it's about $1.6 million total, and we've got about $500 in personal.
Councilman Swatowski, can I ask you a question? Where are you getting the 12-mile address from?
Off the memo from Scott Adkins on American Modular Cooling on the third page, the 30810 12 mile, and the 30744 on the second and third page.
Should be 3081.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I had given you the update. I didn't type that other one, so I gave you the single pager that has the addresses. That may have been something that was put together administratively.
Actually, she has 12 miles. It should be Grossbeck.
Yeah. But the single pager you have, which is the three-point bullets, indicates Grossbeck and is Grossbeck on the applications.
I'm just trying to get a handle on, you know, we've kind of looked at these in two ways, real and personal. And I'm just trying to make sure I have the idea of what those break down at. And I'm thinking it's a little bit more real property than personal property. Is it two parts real to one part personal?
I would say that's possible because of the purchases of equipment that we will need to purchase for the expansion of the new facility and enhance the equipment that we do have or replace it. So those will be new purchases on the personal property.
Okay. Mike, have I got that about right? Is that, you know, $500,000 in personal and about $1 million in real?
Roughly.
Okay.
That's about right.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Any other questions? Seeing none, this is a public hearing. Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard on this agenda item? Anybody from the public wish to be heard? Seeing none. A motion to close the public hearing is in order.
So moved.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Mr. Thomason, do we have to do a public hearing on each individual one?
No, you did the public hearing to establish the plant rehabilitation district. Okay.
Okay.
Your next motion should be to establish that.
Okay. Councilwoman McCartney.
Mayor, I'll make the motion to establish a plant rehabilitation district and create an industrial facility exemption certificate for American Modular Tooling at 30744 Grossbeck Highway and 30810 Grossbeck Highway.
It should actually be to create an industrial district, development district. I know you're reading from the agenda. The agenda is not correct.
Okay. I thought I said and create an industrial development district. No.
You said industrial facilities exemption certificate. But you're establishing the rehabilitation district. The motion is to establish a rehabilitation district and the industrial development district.
That's the motion. That.
I got a motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty.
It's not your fault.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Okay.
Mayor, I think I have a procedural question.
Go ahead.
Mr. Tomlinson.
Mm-hmm.
Agenda item number 5 as written, where does that fall within the order that we're proceeding in?
Your next, well, because
I
That would be the transfers.
Yeah.
So that would be after you establish.
So if we have agenda item four, and then 4A, 4B, and 4C, does five still stand as five?
My suggestion is that you hold the public hearing on five, and then we make our motions on the specific exemption certificates as listed in this memo given to you by Mr. Atkins. Does everybody understand that? That's how we've amended the agenda at this point.
All right. Then the next item is public hearing in connection with application to transfer an industrial facilities exemption certificate from the City of Warren to the City of Roseville, American Modular Tooling LLC, Paul Marino Gauges, Inc., 30744 Grosbeck Highway. Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard on this agenda item?
Seeing none, I motion to close public hearing.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Iuto, supported by Councilman Shoemaker, to close public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion. Public hearing is closed. Now, we are going back to 4A, right?
Yeah, we need to make a motion. We need to make the motion to approve.
Yeah. Okay. This is...
Mr. Mayor?
No.
Can we... we're going to go through them by bullet, right?
Right.
Yeah. So we're on the first
4A, bullet. I'm going to call it.
5A. Okay.
John, it's going to be 5A because we just did 4. 4 was the...
No, that was the... That was the creating the...
No, right.
The district.
You did the public hearing.
Yeah.
On the district, establishment of the district. And you created the district. Mm-hmm. And then you just did the public hearing on the transfer. Because you also did the public hearing on the establishment of the exemption certificates,
right,
as well. So you're covered on the public hearing. Right. Now you just need to take action on each one of the requests.
Okay. On the amended agenda item 4A, 4B, and 4C.
Yeah.
Okay.
Correct.
So, is there any questions regarding 4A to the petitioner?
Just reading the bullet there, it's consideration of a request for a 7-year exemption on real and personal property. And I guess it's for us to decide, are we going to continue with the, you know, looking at things real and personal, looking at them differently? But the request is for 7 years.
I believe we were asking for 12.
Okay, you're asking for 12.
But the criteria was 7.
They qualify for 12 under our new policy.
So under this bullet, request for a 7-year exemption certificate. What is that? Where does that come
from? I don't know. Not for me.
Mr. Atkins, maybe you can fill in the blanks here.
Right. The applications as submitted call for... As submitted by the petitioner, request a 7-year exemption at 30744 Grosbeck, new, real, and personal. They request a 6-year exemption and a 5-year certificate transfer at 30810 Grosbeck. And they are asking for consideration in a 5-year exemption transfer at 30744 Grosbeck. So there are three different applications that came. Those are the petitioner's requests. In comparing the dollar amounts on each of the requests, the dollar amounts allow them a higher scoring criteria. So their application has asked for, again, 7, 6, 5 transfer, and 5 transfer. However, their dollar amounts, when paired up to the city policy, would afford them granting of a higher amount if the city thus considers so.
Is that cleared up for you, Councilman Swatowski?
We're getting there. We're getting
those numbers came directly, the numbers. But the bullet points you're referencing, I don't know, but they are directly from the physical application.
Okay. I'm just looking at what we did last time on Peninsular, which was similar. It's about $2.25. This one's about $1.6. And we went 8 years personal and 4 years real. So I'm thinking, you know, this is similar to that.
Take them or we don't take them.
So I'm thinking 8 personal, 4 real. would be my motion.
Okay, I have a motion by Councilman Swatowski for 8 years.
8 years personal.
Personal and 4 years real. Do I have a support?
I have a question.
Okay, Councilman Shoemaker.
Mike Connors, this is the property that's got the rehabilitation attached to it, right?
Yes. Yes, so the rehabilitation district includes the new facility, or the functionally obsolete building that's there.
That's what I wanted to hear you say.
Functionally obsolete, it is, in every sense of the word. Ask Linda. It's outlived its usefulness. The plant, so that includes the building essentially across the street from the great, the recycling center.
Yes.
And it, adjacent to that is a vacant lot.
So it might be good for us to give a little bit more, because they're taking something that's basically going to sit and have no use for a long time.
Right. Under this Act, Public Act 198, the plant rehabilitation district allows to rehabilitate an existing structure, where under a traditional industrial development district, you cannot rehabilitate. You can only build new investment, new machines. You know, you can't rehab. Only under a plant rehab district, and that's why, you know, we're using this tool in this case.
Okay, thanks, Mike. So I guess in negotiations, I wonder if we should be maybe a little bit more generous. That's where I'm coming across. That's where I'm at. Thank you, Mayor.
Yes, ma'am.
Councilwoman McCartney, did you have something?
No, he asked exactly what I was going to ask.
Okay.
I agree with that.
Put a number on it.
Mayor, I'm going to second the motion so that we can further discuss before we vote.
Okay.
And I thoroughly expect to have an amendment to my second to a higher value.
Okay. I have a motion and I have a second. Any further discussion?
I have a question.
Councilman Shoemaker.
Can Councilman Swatowski repeat what his motion was?
It was 8 on the personal and 4 on the real. And I thought you made a good point. Functionally obsolete probably justifies raising it. Now we're just talking about raising it to what?
Well, I'm thinking 12 and 8. Personal 12, 8 on the real.
Mayor, prior to taking any action, can I suggest that we, and I forget your name, ma'am. And you're from the MEDC.
Macomb County
Planning and Development. She may have some input on that particular issue.
Ma'am, please.
Especially because of some of the procedures we're dealing with, this transfer versus non-transfer.
First of all, I am Camille Solda, Macomb County Planning and Economic Development Department, 1 South Main Street, Mount Clemens, Michigan, 48043. I'd just like to make a few comments, and if you have any questions regarding, this is a little confusing. About a year ago, we ran into a similar situation here in Roseville. It was confusing that time too, so it sounds pretty normal to me. This is not the typical, I know you're used to regular tax abatement and just a request and a public hearing and an approval. What Mike is telling you about the plant rehabilitation district, we rarely get those. This is a real benefit to whatever community this is done in. Because as Mr. Shoemaker said, you're taking a building that is, and it's really functionally obsolete. So you're having an empty building that needs a lot of work being repurposed, re-outfitted. They're doing that second building and combining them. This is definitely a good thing for the city. Secondly, the transfer is fine. I think we talked about that at the special meeting, where it goes from the state back to the company as long as it's approved at the local level. And because of the fact that this is a valuable project to a city, and I understand, Mr. Swatowski, your concerns, all communities are dealing with it. But in this case, I would encourage generosity for the reason that they're taking a building that I think you would have a hard time filling. And maybe that's a little too blunt for my position, but I'm very direct and I'm very forthright when I go through this process. So do you have any other questions for me? And did that answer anything you needed,
any
Mr.
questions?
Tomlinson?
No, that helped.
Okay.
Ma'am, in your expertise, The building that we were talking about, it's been vacant for a number of years. So for them to come in and rehab it and then ask for a tax abatement, that's not unusual.
It's not unusual, but it's also not typical in the work that Jim and I do to do a plant rehab district. We typically do the new investment on an existing building that is functional. So this is kind of, I guess in one sense you could call it typical in an inner ring suburb or in the city of Detroit, where you're taking a building that is in dire needs of upgrading. But when it gets to the point where it's obsolete, it puts it in a special category. And most communities are generous.
Do you know who pays the taxes on that building as it sits now?
Unfortunately, I don't have Jim's file with me.
Mr. Atkins, do you know?
I don't offhand. I don't know if Mr. Connors
is the bank?
Is aware of it. I don't believe it was bank-owned at this point. I think it was still
Mrs.
a private.
Mrs. Marino says Paslin Company.
Well, let me ask the owner. Is Paslin the taxes Company. Current? When you purchased the building, did you have to pay any bank
yes,
taxes?
Yes, actually, we closed on it last week, and everything was up to date.
Okay. All right.
I believe I have
Mr. Mayor.
Hold on. Okay. All right.
Councilman Shoemaker suggested 12 and 8 based on it being a functionally obsolete building. The one we just did a couple months ago, Comfort Inn, we did 12 and 8. So I'd say we're, you know, we've got a reason to be, it was a larger project, but we've got, with the functionally obsolescence of a place, we've got a reason to go to a higher amount. I'd agree to the 12 and 8. Even though it was scored by the city at 11 years.
Okay, is that, you're amending your motion then?
Yeah.
Councilman Ayuto, are you amending your second?
I am.
Okay, any further discussion?
12 for one. All right, if I could clarify that new motion.
12 for personal, 8 for real.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm gonna weigh in here for a change in regards to this. You know, the citizens of Roseville probably don't know this, but we have 60 vacant buildings in the Grosbeck corridor and surrounding industrial areas. And I commend you for coming in to buy this building and to do this. And I'm glad that we can help you out. It's not a 12 and 12, but a 12 and 8 is very good. And I just hope other people, as such as yourself, they're in business, see this and want to come into Roseville after this. And with that, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. It has been granted. 4A. Now 4B. It's a consider request for an exemption certificate and transfer from 30810 Grosbeck Highway real property transfer from the city of Warren. Am I correct on that, Mr. Tomlinson?
That's what I understand the request to be.
Okay. What's the wishes of the council on that one?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
This one is totally real property as I'm reading it. I'd propose 8 years, consistent with the previous one where we gave 8 years on the real property.
Also,
okay, I have a.
It's a transfer.
It's a transfer. Well, no, it's an exemption certificate and transfer.
Okay.
So I have a motion by Councilman Swatowski, supported by Councilman McCartney, for an 8 year exemption. All in favor?
Yeah, John.
I think to clarify, hold on.
Please.
Is, you're dealing with real property where you're looking for a 6 year on new and 5 year on transfer. I think 1 year has already been utilized. So the maximum you can do is 6 year and approve the 5 year transfer, which basically adds up to be an 11 year abatement left. Understand what I'm saying? Because they've used one, they used 1 year in Warren. They're now looking to transfer the remaining. What happened is Warren granted them a 12 year.
And there's 5 years left, correct?
I was thinking that was the third bullet.
Yeah,
the 5 year transfer.
No, this is part of the second application. There's a 5 year transfer plus an additional six.
So they
that's what the motion should be.
They did one and now they're
correct. Because you got to accept the entire transfer.
Oh, okay.
Can't change the transfer.
Can't change it. And that'll be true. I'm sorry.
I withdraw my motion.
Okay, Councilwoman McCray.
Would that be true, too, then, for C? Or no?
Correct.
Yeah, that would be, okay.
Well, C is just a five-year transfer, they're asking that to be transferred.
Can't make a difference on that either.
Can't change.
Okay, perfect, thank you.
Okay, so do I, Councilman Swetoski withdraws his motion, so do I have a new motion?
Go ahead, you all do it?
No, jump in, water's fine.
I will have the six-year exemption certificate, consider the request for a six-year exemption certificate, and a five-year, am I reading this right?
Exemption certificate.
Exemption certificate, transfer at 30810 Grossbeck Highway.
Support.
Okay, so I have a motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilman Swetoski. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Okay, next item is 4C, consider a request for a five-year exemption certificate transfer at 30744 Grossbeck Highway, personal property transfer from the City of Warren. Okay.
I make a motion to approve the request for a five-year exemption certificate transfer at 30744 Grossbeck Highway.
Support.
A motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty, to approve the request for a five-year exemption certificate transfer at 30744 Grossbeck Highway. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Just a question, Mr. Chair. Just wanted to make sure we didn't have to do a public hearing or anything on this one.
We did that, I think. I think we've already, I've asked that question of Mr. Thompson.
We did it with the other public hearing.
All right.
Okay.
It was all part and parcel of that other agenda item.
Yeah. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Number six, request adoption of ordinance to amend Chapter 38, Section 38-1, to provide that in the event the council meeting that is scheduled to be held on Tuesday, that is a legal holiday, that such meeting shall be held within 10 business days, either prior to or succeeding the legal holiday, to provide for repealer, severability, and effective date. Mr. Thompson.
Yes, this is the easiest agenda item of the night. Thank you. Basically, we're looking to amend the ordinance to allow you to move the meeting date either 10 days prior to or after the legal holiday. For example, this year Christmas falls on a Tuesday, which we have a meeting scheduled for. This would allow you either to move up that meeting or move it back within 10 days. It's up to you as far as the discretion, but before you can do that, the ordinance had to be amended because it provided for a two-day window after the Tuesday that it was scheduled. This, in effect, will allow you to move that date to a date that's more feasible, because during that holiday week, obviously, a lot of people are on vacation, out of town. Once the 20 days expires, there'll be an action item before council to move that date. It may be the recommendation that you move it to the week prior, then instead of doing it the week after, which would then be the holiday week for January 1st. So.
Okay, are there any further questions to Mr. Tomlinson? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council?
Mayor, I'll make the motion to move the...
It basically just approve the ordinance as presented.
Okay, thank you. Approve the ordinance as presented. We're moving it 10 days prior to?
Prior to or after. That's what the ordinance provides.
Okay. So we don't have to say that.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty to amend the ordinance, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. I'd like to say one, this evening I have no appointments, but for the viewing public at home, we got deluged with a number of these items, and unfortunately, the city manager secretary is off on a bereavement, so this program usually we have together, and it was kind of part and parcel of what we normally do. So I know there's a lot of people at home watching this. We do know what we're doing up here. It's just that things got confused in transition here because of the ambiguous language that the person used that came in to take care of the agenda. With that being said, the reports of the city manager.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to add on to this. I mean, I apologize for the confusion this evening, but if I may, if you'll allow me, I want to break it down a little bit farther for you. First of all, yes. In fact, my assistant's been off on bereavement, and that has obviously caused a number of dilemmas. She puts these together, as you know, and does a very good job. I do want to thank Linda Huck for stepping in and trying to fill the gap. I had hoped tonight to try to be able to make some clarification for you on these items by putting my little one-pager out. It is difficult at best when we're dealing with these IFT requests, especially this time of year. The deadlines for these to be received and sent and action taken in order to forward to the state of Michigan is the 31st of October. So we are deluged each year at this time, generally with these requests. So there is your first issue, that you had a number of these all coming to you at once. Number two, they were not your normal requests that you often see. The Plant Rehabilitation Act is something new, and the consideration on that makes it unique as well. Plus, we had, as Councilmember Swatowski had mentioned, one of the largest requests you've probably ever seen from RCO Engineering. This was a significant investment. So they were deep and detailed matters. I think what confuses it even further is the policy that we adopted here several months back is a policy that sets forth a scoring criteria that takes into account a combination of real and property together to come up with the accumulated point system and number of years. Certainly, I'd like to be able to add this to one of our workshop sessions, special meetings for discussion, because I think that we really need to look, if we're going to split these items between real and personal, we need to split that policy, because that policy does not indicate that way, and it really isn't fair for the petitioners to look at a policy and perhaps come in with an expectation that they've hit a 12-year range because of the scoring criteria. And that may be our fault lying here at the city because of having one policy. So I think that we should probably have some discussion at dividing that policy and that scoring criteria into a real portion and a personal portion. And I think that would make it clear on the expectations going forward. So I will indulge you with that discussion at some point. I think that would make it much easier, and certainly would make it clearer for any applicants knowing what they're looking at, instead of coming in perhaps with the hopes of a 12-year number for both. So again, I apologize for the confusion, but I do think that there were a number of circumstances here that kind of made the, I hate to call it perfect storm, because it certainly wasn't perfect. So I thank you for your patience and perseverance in us getting through this. And I'm not too mad at the clerk for kicking me every time that we had to make changes, so I will heal. But again, thank you for that and your understanding under the circumstances. I have a couple of other items for you. We did receive notification from the State of Michigan Department of Treasury that the city has been successful in receiving one of the EVIP feasibility study grants. And this is a $20,000 grant award for the Roseville, East Point, and Fraser Water Reservoir feasibility study. As you know, we made an application several months ago, so we have received that grant, and we'll begin to have discussions with the other communities on going forward with the feasibility study. That award was just announced. We have not received any notification on the SAFER grant in regards to firefighter staffing. They have issued out the first of those grants, but we have not been given an award as of yet or received any information, so we're still waiting to hear the status of our application on that SAFER grant. And that will potentially have a budget implication for us, depending on which way that goes. We have some notifications on some road projects, fairly lengthy, so I'll try to go through them as quickly as I can and hopefully as clearly as I can. Groveland, both sections of Groveland have been completed with the exception of, again, some small punch list items. Common Road, the contractor began pouring the eastbound lane of Common Road on Tuesday, October 9th, started at Gratiot and heading west. It's anticipated to take 3 days in each of the pouring, weather permitting, and he's still moving forward. As you can see, they did some of the crossovers. We did have a change here at the entrance coming into City Hall off of Common and had some minor detours, so that project's continuing to move forward. They're in the process of wrapping up the joint seal programs and the open cut sanitary sewer project scheduled to start and did start on the 15th, so that is still in progress. We have received notification from the Michigan Department of Transportation that they're going to be doing some freeway sign upgrades on I-696 and the 696 service drives within the city. This will be October 25th and 26th. Also, there will be a closure of the westbound lanes of I-94 at Fraso from Monday, October 29th through Friday, November 2nd, for work on a message and display signboard, so that'll have an impact in the city on traffic. And then MDOT has scheduled a public meeting regarding the I-94 project, which is the 11-mile to Masonic project. That meeting will be held here in the Aaron Auditorium on Thursday, November 8th, from 4 to 7 p.m. Now, some of that work and the prep work, they've already started, but they will be having a public information meeting on that here at the city. And we'll see that this information is now added to the website and also to the cable television channel for our residents. Those are the items that I have for council this evening. I'd be glad to answer any questions that you may have.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins this evening? Seeing none, we'll move into reports of city attorney. Mr. Thomas.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. This evening I have nothing to report, but I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Does anybody have any questions for Mr. Thomas on this evening? Seeing none, we'll move into the second hearing of the public. Be for any city business. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address, address the chair. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order, will correct their language, or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Anyone not adhering to these rules will be called out of order by the chair. Anybody from the public wish to be heard this evening? Good evening, Mr. Clover.
Good evening, Council Administration, Mayor. Mike Clover, 29130 East Britton Court, Roseville. Keep on wanting to say 19130. I don't know why. But anyhow, a couple things. We have our annual Knights of Columbus pancake French toast breakfast coming up November 4th from 10 a.m. until 1 p.m. in the lower level of Sacred Heart Church. The menu consists of pancakes, French toast, sausage, orange juice, milk, and coffee, and maybe a few extra goodies. We're not sure yet. But come on down. It's $6 for adults and $3 for children, and we are getting very, very good remarks about that breakfast. That's taking place every month. So you should come on down and see what it's like, see what all the buzz is about. And second, that's November 4th. And second, just out of curiosity, the HAFA investigation that we had on Florida and Kelly that attracted national attention, we had that extra security, we had extra police, we had people from the state, from the county, obviously from all three major channels here in the city or here in the Detroit area. Who pays for all that? Is that citizens who have to pay for all that overtime? How does that work?
Well, we won't pay the newspaper reporters, but for the security of the, if there is a crime scene, we pay for that, Michael.
So all the investigation that took place, which they had to do lawfully, I know, by law, they had to do that, but the taxpayers put all that bill.
Yes, they did.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Your Honor, Mayor, if I can, to answer Mr. Clover's questions on that part. Just so everyone is aware, the police department only expended 6.5 hours of overtime on this. Most of the work was done during the course of regular business, so that was very nominal, and we had an expense less than $30 of actual cost, and that was for a lock that had to be purchased to secure the building during the investigation. All of the services from Michigan State Police, MSU, Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, there was no charge for any of those services to the city. So I think that's exceptional, and I commend Chief Berlin and the members of the department for doing their best to keep the dollars in check on this. So very nominal, probably less than most investigations that we undertake here. Thank you, Mayor.
Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Yes, sir.
Okay. Hi, I'm Dave Chesney, 30440 Normal. Yeah, I just want to talk about our city's future, about our future in Roseville and our neighboring cities of South Macomb County. Well, I've said it before, as you know, Detroit is continuing its downward spiral. Crime and blight are out of control. And a recent survey said about 40% of Detroit's population, which exists now, plans on leaving Detroit in the next 5 years. That would mean that in the next census of 2020, the population of Detroit would drop below 500,000. Wow. We have to ask ourselves, where does that put us in South Macomb County? Are we going to get responsible working class homeowners or lower income renters, some on Section 8? I guess we'll see. But it seems clear racial and social change is happening quite rapidly in South Macomb County. Look at the drive-by shooting last year on Lanier Street. We might remember that, I do. And the suspect in the Detroit Riverboat shooting a few months ago, guess what? That suspect doesn't live in Detroit. They live in St. Clair Shores. And what about the carjacking on Collingwood? Pretty scary for that woman and her children. That was probably Detroit street thugs coming out here and committing crimes. So, what you know, Roseville and our neighboring cities of South Macomb County need to take a firm stand, that is, with stepped up code enforcement and increased public safety, stepped up code enforcement, and a crackdown on these so-called broker landlords who want to buy up multiple properties. And we must continue to pursue negligent property owners in court through the Nuisance Abatement Act. Southfield Mayor Brenda Lawrence said recently, we're not putting up with the crap that is going on across 8 Mile in Northwest Detroit. So also said Oakland County Executive L. Brooks Patterson and other mayors of Southeast Oakland County. Roseville and our neighbors in South Macomb County also need to step up and take a firm stand to save our city's quality of life against the crime and the decay knocking at our door. You know, cities that border Detroit in Wayne County, like Harper Woods, Redford Township, Dearborn Heights, are experiencing a lot of problems. Not even the Grosse Pointes are immune to the Detroit spillover problems. So I ask the council that we continue to make the right decisions and not cut our public safety and our other crucial services. Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anybody else wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else wish to be heard? Seeing none, motions or items for discussion by City Council. Councilman Switowski.
Well, we did have a lot of tax abatements tonight because the deadline was on us, so everyone was rushing to get in. And I think everyone can be very confident that we are in compliance with the Open Meetings Act, because it's clear we don't decide all the stuff beforehand. We do it like we're supposed to do. We come to the table, we negotiate, we discuss what we think is right. I'm not always right. That's why we have seven people. So between the seven of us, we come up with what's reasonable. And I think that's a good thing. It's a good thing, because when you have a difference of opinion, you have discussion, you get to a better decision. So I'm not unhappy with tonight's meeting. I thought we did well. And I think the manager is exactly right. I think when we discussed this scoring criteria, we had a full discussion in a study session, and we came up with the idea that, hey, with what the state's doing with personal, we should look at these two things separate. And we've kind of done that. But we never went back and changed that scoring criteria. It would be good to do that, because that is the way we're thinking, and so the scoring should reflect that. That's all I have, Mayor.
Councilman Ayuda.
Thank you, Mayor. Like I usually do, I'll give a rec authority update. As chairman of the rec authority, I just think it's a good way to keep communications open to the residents. This Saturday is the mom-to-mom sale over at the Sycamore location, Recreation Department. And that is from 9:30 to 1 o'clock. Vendor space is actually sold out, but admission to the event is $1. And obviously there's going to be a lot of goods there from the mom-to-mom sale. Saturday night also is the Trick or Trunk over at Veterans Memorial Park. And that is from 6 to 7 p.m. Kids can buy a wristband so that they can go trick-or-treating throughout the park. And there's only 50 wristbands left. So Call the Recreation Department at 586-445-5480 to get your wristbands for Saturday night. Then on November 1st, day after Halloween, there's the annual Rumblin' Tumblin' Pumpkin Roll Down over at Huron Park. And that will start sharply at 6 p.m. And that is just everybody lines up at the top of the hill with their carved pumpkins, roll them down, throw them down, watch them smash, and it's a big old mess. But it is a lot of fun, and a lot of people do attend it. And the Boy Scouts usually are there to help clean up and get the park back spick and span. And finally, the Big Bird Run is Sunday, November 11th. Pre-registration has begun, and you can pre-register now through November 7th at the Recreation Department. So support the Recreation Authority of East Point and Roseville. A lot of things going on. I'll say happy birthday, Mr. P, and take care of each other. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Shoemaker.
Thank you, Mayor. I have nothing to add tonight. Thank you.
Councilwoman Hagerty.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to offer my condolences to the city manager, Secretary Yvette, and her family on the loss of her grandmother. And I'd like to thank Mr. Atkins and Mr. Tomlinson for getting us through these confusing issues tonight. We really appreciate your help. And have a happy and safe Halloween. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilwoman McCartney.
Thank you. I just want to ditto what Ms. Hagerty said. Sorry about the confusion up here. And thank you to Linda for stepping up and giving us our little cheat sheet here. And Yvette, we do miss you, and hopefully we'll have you by next meeting. That's all I have.
Mayor Pro Tem.
I have nothing to add, Mr. Mayor.
With that, all I'm going to do is wish my daughter a happy birthday today. And my condolences to Yvette and her family for their loss. With that, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. All in favor?
Aye.